Any of you heard that name?
Yes.
He wrote about the necessity in Europe of an old new land for the Jews. As a reporter, he witnessed the trial of Alfred Dreyfus in Paris, a Jewish officer who was made a scapegoat for French military failures in an infamous trial drenched in anti-Semitism. Dreyfus was sentenced to death, but Emile Zola wrote an open letter to the president of France under the title J'accuse, I accuse. He wrote, "Rumors flew of the most horrible acts, the most monstrous deceptions, lies that were affront to our history. The public naturally were taken in. No punishment could be too harsh." I ask, is this not today with the horrible acts, the monstrous deceptions that are hurled against Israel, that are an affront not only to our history, but also to what we offer and contribute to mankind? Zola went on to write, "It is a lie, all the more odious and cynical in that its perpetrators are getting off free without even admitting it." Isn't that true today about the BDS movement? That's the Boycotts, Divestment and Sanctions movement, the anti-Israel lobby and the misguided who spread false accusations against the Jewish state and hold it up to a standard that no nation on earth can reach. There is a miscarriage of justice being perpetrated today against Israel that I will talk about later. Then Emile Zola wrote again to the French president, "These, Mr. President, are the facts that explain how this miscarriage of justice came about. The evidence of Dreyfus's character, his influence, his lack of motive, and his continued affirmation of innocence combine to show that he is the victim of a lurid imagination, of circles surrounding him, and the dirty Jew obsession that is the scourge of our time. Today, despite the best efforts to be a shining light unto nations, the overwhelming weight of anti-Semitism is pressing down on Israel. Israel is today the new Dreyfus." Things began to change with the downfall of the Ottoman Empire that ruled all of the Middle East, including Palestine, which was nothing more than a district of Greater Syria, again a desolate place. Already in 1917, Lord Balfour, the British Foreign Secretary, on behalf of the British government, viewed in favour of the establishment in Palestine of the national home of the Jewish people. This decree, which was given to the Zionist Federation of Great Britain, was not all that surprising. It was, after all, the relevant political, spiritual feeling of much of Christian Europe at that time, raised in a firm and fundamental belief in the Old Testament and the Bible that shaped their political thinking. They applied their knowledge of the Bible to the geopolitical reality of the time here. It was not only natural and right that Israel be re-established. There were no demands at that time for an Arab Palestinian state at that time, because all the Arab demands had been fully met by giving them Jordan, Syria, Lebanon, Iraq, and Saudi Arabia. The motion there was transferred to the San Remo document declaration. I'd been in San Remo in 1920. Following World War I, the Allied Supreme Powers resolved to allocate Class A mandates for administering the former Ottoman lands. They included the recommendation that Palestine should be mandated to be the national home of the Jewish people. The mandates were confirmed at the League of Nations in 1922 with a unanimous adoption of the mandate for Palestine, which divided Palestine into a Jewish state and an Arab state over the River Jordan as Jordan. It clearly formulated and formalized in international law the establishment in Palestine of the national home of the Jewish people. Look, I mentioned this deliberately, because defining the national home of the Jewish people was repeatedly stressed, not by us, of what was then the United Nations of the time. This is being rejected today by Mahmoud Abbas, who refuses to admit or even recognize the legality of a Jewish state, even as he pushes with international approval for land that has been decreed in law to the Jews. This is a continuation of Arab rejection of the Arab state in the United Nations partition plan of 1947, which led to the Arab invasion of Israel in 1948. It is not today about territory, it is about Israel's existence. With the transfer of all legal instruments and mandates to the United Nations, the legal status of Palestine as again the national home of the Jewish people was further enshrined in Article 80 of the United Nations Charter. This is the same United Nations General Assembly that tried to bring resolutions against Israel, despite the fact that it is decreed in international law the status and enshrined in the United Nations Charter. We see today international dissolution of these basic rights applied against Israel, and only Israel, as if they didn't exist. They are swept aside as irrelevant. If Israel's right to exist under the mandate and the United Nations Charter, then neither are the rights of Syria, Lebanon, Saudi Arabia, Iraq, even Hungary and Austria, who were there by virtue of League of Nations mandates at the same time as the mandate for Palestine decreed Israel to be a national home for the Jewish people. No other mandate in the Middle East decreed any specific people or groups. All the other mandates for Mesopotamia and Syria throughout the Middle East spoke about peoples and communities. The Holocaust put blatant anti-Semitism to shame. It lay dormant for decades, gathering its strength, waiting to find the right opportunity to reawaken and show itself. It found it in anti-Zionism. They craftily discriminate between Israel and the Jews, but they mean the same thing. We saw that with the widespread attacks against Jews in all the Arab countries once the Jewish state of Israel was declared. They didn't attack Israelis there. They attacked and killed Jews. They expelled them from their lands. Jewish refugees that fled Arab lands between 48 and 50 were greater in number than the Arabs that were ordered to leave their homes by Arab command as Arab armies attacked the nascent state of Israel. By all estimates, in 1948, when the Arabs attacked Israel, and the Arab High Command is mentioned, all the documented proof is in the book, ordered Arabs to leave while they drove the Jews into the sea, those they couldn't kill. The ones that ran away numbered 550,000. The estimated number of Jews who were forced out of Arab lands came to between 800 and 850,000. But unlike the Arabs who fled to neighboring Arab lands, the Jews that reached Israel were not treated like refugees to be kept into their third and fourth and fifth generation by the international community. They were welcomed, given citizenship, given housing, given education, given employment, and integrated into society. In Israel, those that came as persecuted refugees ended up becoming presidents and prime ministers of Israel and leaders in all walks of life in our country. In the meantime, the Arabs that were taken in by the Arab nations in most cases are treated as stateless, not entitled to higher education, not entitled to any profession, kept stateless, kept as a political pawn. That is an international crime for anybody who claims to stand for the rights and human rights for Palestinians or anybody. I love Israel. It's the Jewish dream of 3,000 years come true. It's our homeland, and it's the center of our people, culturally, intellectually, spiritually. It's our promised land. And with all that, I said, it seems odd that out of all the places of the earth, the land of Israel was chosen geographically, politically, strategically to be in the midst of one of the toughest, most brutal regions on earth. Amen. Given Israel is the 100th smallest country in the world, and the international community is trying to make us smaller still. 70% of our population, including me, live in the low-lying central coastal plain, and I live on the clifftops of the Mediterranean in Netanya. I am just 9 miles, 14 kilometers from Tulkarm. Tulkarm is the Arab town where a number of the suicide bombers and car bombers came to my town to destroy my people. Tulkarm lies by the 6 highway. That's one of the main north-south artery roads in Israel. That is, according to the 1967 borders, is to be part of the new Palestine. A 14-minute car ride from there to my home. I invite you, when you go home, take your car out of your parking space, drive 14 minutes and stop. That is the distance from my house on the clifftops of Netanya to a new Palestinian state. And I live in the center of London, in Israel, center of Israel, in the wasteland of Israel, where 70% of the population live. When you take off from Ben Gurion Airport as your place, plane takes off, look down on Israel, and then look up to the hills, because on the heights of those hills is Palestine, overlooking Ben Gurion Airport. That's how narrow our country is. We have no natural resources. Actually, Shimon Peres, I was at a conference last week, and Shimon Peres said that God gave us a favor, did us a favor, he didn't give us oil. Why? Because he gave the Arabs oil. They just pump this stuff out of the ground, they get filthy rich, they waste their money, and they have hardly developed further than the 10th century. We don't have any oil. We have lots of sand. You'll see a lot of it as you go to the Dead Sea tomorrow. But the natural resources we found is the one we found between our ears, the brain power, our ingenuity, which has made us the wonder of the 20th century and one of the world leaders of the 21st century. Why is this? It's because we Jews never accept what you tell us. We argue, we question, we think. Someone once said to me that the Jews need to live in Israel the way that fish need to live in water. Our water is the spiritual air in which we breathe. But again, why are we the Jewish people destined to live in a place that is inherently so challenging and so dangerous to our existence? Couldn't the Holy Land have been a little bit more comfortable? This is where we question God and argue with God, you see. Could we have some nicer neighbors? But you know what? That's our fate. Jews believe in a God that demands of us to do right, but also to protect those rights. We have seen down the centuries that it's been insufficient to act benevolently in foreign societies. Whenever we have contributed to societies in which we thought we could integrate and find our resting place, we have been abused, despised, spat at, assaulted, demonized, delegitimized, and eventually annihilated. What we didn't do, what we failed to do, was to protect ourselves, to defend ourselves from those we thought would appreciate our gifts and our integration. What was this telling us? It was telling us that we had to find our way back to our ancient land, to develop that land, to use that barren land as a base for the only natural resources that have been forged within the Jewish people, and that is our spirit and our brain power, our genius, our inventiveness, our ingenuity, to help mankind, to be a light unto nations, but also to protect that land and its people from those who wish to destroy us. That is why I do what I do, countering the assaults on Israel's legitimacy, exposing the lies and the dangerous misguided principles that attack Israel and only Israel. Promote the word of truth, even as I am drowned out by the hypocrisy and double standard that are hurled against Israel. It's good to pray, but that's not enough. God expects us to do more. It's not so hard to give a bit more of your time to speak up and act for Israel. Let me give you one biblical anecdote to prove my point. Recently, in synagogues around the world, we read a portion of the Bible, the Torah, which told the story of Moses, who heard the voice of God demanding of him that he leave his home and return to Egypt to plead with the mighty Pharaoh to let his people go to a land that God would show him. Moses, it's reported in the Bible, refused God's command four times before he accepted the task to rescue the Jewish people. Why me? I'm not able. I stutter. Go pick somebody else.
That's right.
I'm here to tell you that it is not a burden to act for justice for the rights of Israel. It is in fact a blessing. Mm-hmm. Jerry will tell you that. I've been so stimulated, so elevated by the advocacy I do for Israel that I feel myself really, truly blessed. The Bible demands of us not just to pray, not to just to live quiet lives like Moses wanted to do, not to let the fate of Israel to your fellow Christians or to others, but to get on your feet and walk the walk and talk the talk. You and nobody else. You and not me. You and not just Jerry. Be a leader for Israel. You know it's the right thing to do. I feel that what I'm doing is called in Hebrew a mitzvah. Mitzvah in Hebrew can either be interpreted as a blessing or as a commandment. That's why every 13-year-old Jewish boy is called up for his bar mitzvah. It's a bold command to be a man and represent your people. Here's one example of the many challenges we face. Why is it that we who have been the victims of Palestinian terror are the ones being threatened by sanctions and worse by the international community for insisting that our inalienable right to protect and secure our homeland? Why is it that the same international community are not imposing the same sanctions and the same punishments on a Palestinian authority that rejects Israeli concessions, that refuse to recognize the Jewish state, that continues a racist and anti-Semitic policy by inciting that the Palestinian state will be Judenrein, free of Jews, and incites its people to future violence and a vision of a world without Israel? Where is the justice? Remember that as you visit Bethlehem tomorrow. Remember that Bethlehem, when Israel was controlling Bethlehem, had a Christian population there was 80%. Today, within Israel, without Bethlehem itself, it's down to less than 15%. I wrote an article listing a lot of the crimes and abuses that have been inflicted on the Christians of Bethlehem since the Palestinian Authority took over. But I can only summarize in the words of the last Christian mayor of Bethlehem, Elias Frege, who predicted a few years ago that the Christian town of Bethlehem would become a town of churches and no Christians. The Palestinians conquered the Sunday people, and now they're coming for the Saturday people. Each of us must do what little he or she can do to stand with the Jewish people, because it's the right thing to do, especially here in the nation state of the Jewish people, Israel. I call on you, each and every one of you, to join the cause. Give that little bit more of yourself to Israel. So here's my final request of you, each of you. This year, 2014, make a commitment, each and every one of you, to perform 14 acts for Israel. 14 acts that promote Israel. 14 acts that challenge the lies and the hypocrisy and the fraud that is being spoken against Israel. Challenge those who attack us. Speak out the truth, the facts, and justice for Israel. Bring others into the fold and act and speak for Israel. Create a network advocating human rights and justice for Israel. You came as friends and supporters. Leave as ambassadors for Israel. Tell your friends, tell your enemies, that in your heart and in your soul, you are an Israeli. Tell them you are a Zionist. Do it for our shared Judeo-Christian values and for our survival. Welcome to Israel, and God bless each and every of you.
Wow. Hallelujah.
I think Barry has opened the door to do something now, and then we'll open it up for some questions. But there is something